thank you for coming tonight. I know it's not Monday, but I'm delighted to see the attendance. It's a very, very important topic, and we are extremely lucky and fortunate to have with us today Ayesha Jalal to talk about a very important issue in world politics and global cultures. But also she's accompanied by Professor Bose from Harvard, in case you wanted to add more information along the way. The lecture and the Q&A shouldn't take more than 1 hour and a half, so we should be done by 7:30, because at some point they have to go back to Boston. So they have to drive back, so they're not staying here, so it's gonna be but we are very lucky to have them. So a quick biographical note, Ayesha Jalal is the Mary Richardson Professor of History at Tufts University, where she teaches at both the History Department and the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. She obtained her BA, majoring in History and Political Science from Wellesley College, and her doctorate in History from the University of Cambridge. Dr. Jalal has been a fellow of Trinity College, Cambridge, a Lever Hume Fellow at the Center for South Asian Studies at Cambridge, Fellow of the Woodrow Wilson Center for International Scholars in Washington, D.C., and Academy Scholar at the Harvard Academy for International and Area Studies. Between 98 and 2003, she was a MacArthur Fellow. She has taught at the university, which is a huge deal, in case you did, those who are not academics. It's an amazing, it's a great accomplishment and a great recognition for anybody in academia or any thinker, writer, or creative person. She has taught at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Tufts University, Columbia University, and Harvard University. Her publications include The Sole Spokesman, Gina, the Muslim League, and the Demand for Pakistan, published in Cambridge by Cambridge University Press, The State of Martial Law, The Origins of Pakistan's Political Economy of Defense, published in 1990 by Cambridge University Press, and Democracy and Authoritarianism in South Asia, A Comparative and Historical Perspective, also published by Cambridge in 1995. Dr. Jalal has co-authored Modern South Asia, History, Culture, and Political Economy, published by Routledge in 1998, and with Sugata Bose, who is here with us tonight, which has been published by Oxford University Press in India and by Sang Emil in Pakistan. Her study of Muslim identity in the subcontinent, entitled Self and Sovereignty, the Muslim Individual and the Community of Islam in South Asia since circa 1850, appeared in 2001. And by a number of publishers. She has also authored Partisans of Allah, Jihad in South Asia, Cambridge, published by Harvard University Press, and also in Pakistan in 2008. She has also edited the Oxford Companion to Pakistani History, Oxford University Press, 2012, and co-edited a bilingual Urdu and English volume entitled Manto, published, I am assuming, in Pakistan in 2012. Her Lawrence Stone lectures given at the Davis Center at Princeton University in April 2011 were published as The Pity of Partition, Manto's Life, Times, and Work Across the India-Pakistan Divide, published by Princeton University Press in 2013. Dr. Jalal's most recent book is The Struggle for Pakistan, A Muslim Homeland and Global Politics, which was available at the reception and was published by Harvard University Press in 2014. So please help me in welcoming Professor Ayesha Jalal.
Thank you so much, Professor Majid, for this generous. Have I lost it again? Sorry. for this generous introduction, and to all of you for coming on a Thursday. I know that this was meant to be on a Monday, but he very accommodated my needs. I'm going to talk to you about my book, my most recent book, The Struggle for Pakistan. And so I'd like to really begin by my first question is, why did I write this book? I don't usually try to explain to people why I write a book, largely because I write a book because I have something that I want to say. But in the instance of this book has been something that I was supposed to do at least 18 years ago, if not even earlier. I kept postponing it. And the reason for my postponement of this was largely because it's very, very hard to get official archives opened in Pakistan. And I kept postponing doing a book on Pakistan until I could see more archives. So I did work on other sorts of things. I wrote other books, which you've heard from Professor Majid. I eventually agreed to write this book, and this is one book I think I can say that I was asked to write by my publishers. They really wanted me to write it, and I eventually did it after I finished The Pity of Partition. And the reason is what I really want to share with you. The reason for doing so was that I wanted to counter the very presentist turn that has entered the narrative about Pakistan, more generally in the globe. Pakistan has an extraordinarily negative profile. And while it may well deserve some negative criticisms, quite a lot if you like, but the extraordinary thing is how little Pakistanis have been able to sort of challenge this representation of them, or to even explain to the world what their history is and why they are in the predicament that they are. So to challenge this presentist turn, I wanted to write a history that was attentive to some of the key shifts in the international context, which informed Pakistan's domestic politics and also its relations with India, its premier enemy and also most important neighbor. So that was my objective. And really, the ultimate really presentist narrative goes like this on Pakistan, which is that Pakistan was basically a mistake. It was born in blood, and so hardly surprising that it exists in blood. That's one explanation. The other one is that Pakistan is a failed state, or is a failing state. Now, I really would like to ask, failing by whose standards? I think that's a very, I think the notion of failed and failing states can be very problematic unless you define your standard. Is it failing by American standards? Is it failing by Indian standards? Or is it failing by some other standards? The third argument, which is perhaps the most sort of easy to dismiss, has recently been articulated since the election of Prime Minister Narendra Modi in India, which is that Pakistan is an irrelevant country. It's an irrelevant country because India wants to grow, and it has been growing, as we all know, and Pakistan seems to be an obstacle to India really attracting even more investment than it would like. At least that's one of the reasons. The other could be India's bureaucracy and red tape. But the fact still remains that Pakistan is a problem for India. India's aspirations to be in the Security Council, Pakistan is a problem, the Kashmir issue, which has been long disputed. So at every level, to say that Pakistan is an irrelevant country does mean that India wants to make progress without having Pakistan constantly be held over its head, that you need a solution in Kashmir, you need to do this, you need to do that. So I think that these arguments are the reasons why I wrote this book. I also wanted to challenge journalistic accounts that have come out on Pakistan that really only look at Pakistan through the prism of terror and more terror. So I think that's also very distorting. Whilst there's no question that there are problems, we need to put them into context and into perspective. And so rather than flatten Pakistan's history out and simply look at what is wrong with the country today, and there's much that is wrong, I think that the historian had to intervene. However, I hope that in future, younger historians who are exposed to more sources will embellish the argument and improve the history. What was needed, I was always told by my colleagues and publishers, that you need a narrative history of Pakistan. You need a story of Pakistan. And because there are lots of political scientists and many people have written on it, but what you needed was a narrative history, and that's what I tried to do. I've tried to do in this book. So let me move on to the next question, Why was Pakistan created? I think Pakistan is a country about which there are many myths, many misconceptions. The difficulty has been that because history was replaced very early on in Pakistan by ideology. What is taught in Pakistan is ideology, the ideology of a Muslim, quote-unquote, homeland, rather than history. It's been very difficult for Pakistanis to come up with historical writings of the quality that could really convey some part of their history to the broader world. And one issue, of course, has to do with why Pakistan was created. The official narratives of Pakistan's creation and the ones that have been commonplace and famous everywhere is that Pakistan was created on account of religion. It was because of religious differences with India that Pakistan was created. Well, I hate to disappoint you to say that that this claim is belied by the historical evidence. How do you explain the creation of a country in 1947 out of India's extremities in the northwestern and northeastern parts, which left at least 35 million at the time in India, making that the largest single minority of Muslims in the world. And Pakistan, of course, with 65 million Muslims divided, albeit by 1,000 miles of Indian territory, was the largest Muslim country in the world. So, I mean, what kind of a solution was that? And today, if you look at the map and you look at the demographics, you see that there are more Muslims who live outside Pakistan, i.e. in India and Bangladesh, than in Pakistan. So what kind of a Muslim homeland was this? So I think this is the question that I would like to talk about. And I just also want to add that if we go even further, in 2050, India will be the largest Muslim country in the world. So I really do think that we need to explain then why was Pakistan created if this is the homeland for India's Muslims. Well, as I argued in my first book, The Sole Spokesman, as some of you would know my argument, it's been around for at least 30 years, to my knowledge, and it's unfortunately regarded as a quote-unquote academic orthodoxy. I'm always uncomfortable with that term, but it has come to be accepted. And what is the argument? I have shown in that book that what Mr. Jinnah was trying to do was to negotiate a power-sharing arrangement at the All India level after the British quit India. He argued that the central apparatus that was created to hold India together by the British was a British construct, and when the British quit India, a new All India Center would have to be negotiated on the basis that there were two nations in India. Muslim, represented by the Muslim majority provinces of the Northwest and the Northeast, i.e. Pakistan, and the Hindu majority provinces known as Hindustan. And that these two would have to come to either treaty arrangements or on matters of common concern, or as sovereign states, or arrive at a confederal arrangement. He also noted that India at that time had as many as 565 plus princely states, accounting for 40% of India's territory, because the British had ruled India in a way where part of India accounted for what was known as British India. And there were 11 provinces of British India. And 40% of India, they did not rule directly. That was called princely India, and indirect rule was administered there. So Jinnah's argument was that the princely states and the Muslim areas could not be coerced into an All India center that would be dominated by the Indian National Congress. And that Muslims were, after 1940, after the outbreak of war in Europe, the Second World War, Jinnah, who had been defeated in the elections of 1937, winning a mere 4.4% of the total Muslim vote cast for the All India Muslim League, managed to really rise from the ashes, largely because the British wanted an excuse, a pretext, to keep constitutional negotiations, constitutional negotiations in cold storage until the war was over and hopefully had been won. So Mr. Jinnah's opportunity came during the war. He made the most of it, and so much so that in 1946, he was able to take the All India Muslim League, which was still a largely ramshackle party organization, to a resounding electoral success, winning every single one of the Central Assembly seats, winning in Punjab very well, but not well enough to be able to form the government on its own, but winning in Bengal as well, and by and large doing extremely well, considering that. So within a mere 10 years from 1937, where it managed only 4.4%, it manages to get almost 100%. So how did this happen? Well, as I've explained, Mr. Jinnah opted for a demand, which came to be known as the Pakistan demand. And I would like to take a minute or two to explain the Pakistan demand to you. First of all, the demand was named, where did the word Pakistan come from? Well, P, it's an acronym for the land of the pure. It's an acronym, sorry. It means the land of the pure. It's an acronym for Punjab, P for Punjab, A for Afghanistan, K for Kashmir, S for Sindh, and Tan for Baluchistan, i.e. there is no mention of Bengal in this acronym, and it was devised by a student at Emmanuel College in Cambridge University, a man called Chaudhry Rahmat Ali. Now, Chaudhry Rahmat Ali, his original conception of Pakistan extended all the way from the Bosphorus, from the Bay of Bengal to the Bosphorus. And so people have always, and he was one amongst many who were circulating schemes that were trying to square the circle of Muslim aspirations for sovereignty and the fact that they were not they did not have any geographical areas where that were contiguous. So the interesting thing that this is another book that I've researched this in Self and Sovereignty, these various schemes, one thing they have in common was that each one of them, even as they demanded territory or made claims to sovereignty, was still envisaging remaining part of India. This is also true of Muhammad Iqbal's famous 1930 presidential speech, in which he called for a state in the Northwest, a Muslim state in the Northwest, but which would remain part of India and would also be the best bet for India against the hungry hordes, as he put it, of Central Asia. So I do think that these are things that we need to keep in mind. So how does partition then come about? Well, in 1939, after the war broke out, the British, as I said, needed a pretext. You know, wasn't a good justification because he was at odds with the Congress. And so he presented a demand called the Pakistan Demand, which basically demanded that the Muslim majority areas in the Northwest and the Northeast ought to be created as sovereign states, but the constituent units within would be sovereign as well. So that was a very interesting. But the fourth paragraph of the resolution that was passed in March 1940, the All India Muslim League resolution, spoke about the constitution in the singular, envisaging reciprocal rights for both sets of minorities, i.e., the rights of non-Muslims in the areas that became part. The Muslim majority areas would be the protection that would be provided for Muslims in the Hindustan areas. Known, unfortunately, as the hostage theory, it was still envisaging an all-India arrangement. So the question is, then how did this work out? Why didn't it work out? I think the reason is that clearly Mr. Jinnah wanted, what he was doing was to use the All India Muslim political category. The British had granted separate electorates to Muslims as early as 1909. And that principle had been retained throughout in the 1919 constitutional reforms and then again in the 1935 Constitutional Government of India Act, which served as the constitutional framework when elections were held in 46. So separate electorates meant that Indian Muslims were a political category. Unfortunately, the British political system, which was not only very restricted, there was no universal adult franchise. I think this is extremely important to recognize. Franchise was based on property and educational qualifications. So it was a very small base, really, that could really vote. I do think that the Government of India Act of 1935, which then, of course, becomes the constitutional framework for India and Pakistan, needs to be looked at in order to understand the context in which these demands were raised. So effectively, what was Mr. Jinnah trying to do? He was trying to build a case for a Muslim homeland on the Muslim majority areas. He himself, of course, was from the minority provinces. It did not suit him to agree to any arrangement where the minority provinces would be left out. So he was envisaging the Pakistan demand as a way to negotiate an equal share of power for Muslims, to have a strong party at the All India level that would then be able to do something for the Muslims in the minority provinces. What he needed were porous borders between Pakistan and Hindustan. And throughout, after 1940, his main argument was that there are two nations, Pakistan and Hindustan, within India. He never spoke about Pakistan and India. And in fact, when Mountbatten, and I'm moving forward, when Mountbatten eventually comes and says, that's all you're going to get, a truncated, mutilated, moth-eaten Pakistan, that he had dismissed out of hand in 1944, and again in 1946, that was based on the division of Punjab and Bengal. So why was that? Well, Mr. Jinnah's entire argument was based on the Muslim right of self-determination. Here he was the context really here, the global context was such that there was talk about self-determination. We know that self-determination was a method by colonial masters to control subject populations, but it did somehow get associated with President Woodrow Wilson. And as a result, it was seen as one way. It was seen as a positive thing. And so Jinnah couched his demand in terms of Muslim self-determination, but you couldn't give Muslim self-determination and then deny it to non-Muslims. Mr. Jinnah didn't bother very much to try and win over the support of the non-Muslims of the areas that he was demanding for Pakistan. And you might ask why. Well, the man had always wanted an arrangement at the All India level. He was a central politician, not a provincial politician. So he wanted to settle the All India arrangement first, come to terms with the Congress. He had tried to do that in 37, and because he had no locus standi, the Congress had dismissed him, which is why his relations with Nehru and subsequently with other elements of the Congress got more and more embittered. But the fact of the matter is that Jinnah was trying to negotiate an All India arrangement that would somehow keep Pakistan as part of the overall Indian whole. And I think this is something that has been very hard for people to understand. People have thought that I'm arguing that Mr. Jinnah didn't want a Pakistan. The problem has been that the Pakistan that emerged cannot be thought of as the Pakistan he wanted all along. He wanted something more. He didn't want Pakistan to be based on a partition of Punjab and Bengal. It was the Congress that demanded the partition of Punjab and Bengal at the behest of the Hindu Mahasabha, the precursor or predecessor, in a sense, of the BJP, if you like. So I do think that needs to be pointed out. So what am I saying? Far from religion being the driving force in the creation of Pakistan, it was provincial dynamics, ultimately, that determined the final denouement. Let me explain that. If Mr. Jinnah had been comfortable with his Muslim support base, if religion was indeed a binding factor for Muslims, bringing them all together, then he might conceivably have tried to work out a plan that the British presented in 1946 at the tail end of their rule in India, when they began thinking of how to get out of India, having won the war, Second World War, but having been absolutely devastated in the process. They were in debt to the United States hugely. The winter of 1945 was unforgettable. The news of the Indian National Army, which had led by Subhas Chandra Bose, who had raised an army from British Indian soldiers in Southeast Asia with the help of the Japanese to fight the British, all of that really made the British very uncomfortable, and they decided to quit. In trying to quit, they offered Mr. Jinnah the option of staying within a federal arrangement. And Mr. Jinnah accepted that in preference for a partitioned Punjab and Bengal. But since the Congress was not willing to allow this grouping that he wanted, was not prepared to confine the All India Center to three subjects only as the cabinet mission plan suggested, there couldn't be any agreement. And so partition it had to be. Mr. Jinnah resisted the partition of Punjab and Bengal, argued that you could not confuse the partition of Punjab and Bengal with the principle of Pakistan. And that's something that's very hard for people to understand. What was he really trying to do? He wanted to use Pakistan to gain a large share of power, but the last thing he needed was a partition of Punjab and Bengal, because then his share would be reduced correspondingly. But in a sense, what I'm saying is that there was a Achilles heel in Jinnah's demand, and that was in demanding self-determination for Muslims and doing nothing for non-Muslims. That explains why, at the end of the day, the Pakistan that emerged was based on a partition of the two main Muslim-majority provinces of Punjab and Bengal. I think that's what I will stop there. But what it basically means is that, you know, my first question in my dissertation, which became my first book, was how did a Pakistan come about that satisfied the interests of its main constituents so poorly? Why do I say that? Well, the two main Muslim-majority provinces where the Muslims could have hoped to dominate were partitioned. And of course, Muslims got exactly what Jinnah had said was a mutilated, moth-eaten Pakistan, something he had resisted. So to say that this is what he wanted might be something that the post partition, post-independence Pakistani state officials felt necessary to, because all modern nation states want to claim success. But in point of fact, it was a case of a strategy going awry, which is one of the reasons why Pakistan had a difficult time starting up as a state. So effectively, I'm saying that until 1946, he's talking about staying within India, and then it takes all of a year of a campaign for Pakistan where Pakistan comes about. So when we say that the preparation was not all there, people had ideas about Pakistan, but nobody really had a clear understanding of what it will eventually be. There was talk about it being an Islamic social justice, a haven for Islamic social justice. There were those who thought it would be an Islamic state. But Mr. Jinnah, who is known to be of a secular bent, made sure that no such commitment was made. He said that the future of Pakistan will be decided by the representatives of the people of Pakistan. So that was quite clear. He avoided efforts by people in the Muslim League to get him to commit himself to framing the future constitution on the basis of this amorphous idea of the Sharia. I won't go into that, but that is one of the arguments. I just want to add that, in fact, because he was secular and the leadership of the Muslim League was deemed to be too westernized and too secular, that all the religious elements, most of the religious elements, did not support the Muslim League until the last minute. And in this regard, I do want to point out that the Jamiat-e-Ulama-e-Hind is one of the most conservative organizations in this period, and it preferred to work with the Congress because of its anti-colonialism than with the Muslim League. So I think that these are things that need to be kept in mind before we assume that Pakistan was created solely in the name of religion. It is true that subsequent rulers of Pakistan have made this a slogan in order to advance their own interests. And I will, of course, elaborate on that. But I thought it might help to put in a little bit of effort on why Pakistan was created. So I'm not going to say very much about the period. I've written about it in the book, the period 47 to 58, when the first military coup takes place and Ayub Khan comes in. But I will sort of summarize my argument just for your purposes. It's commonplace to say that Pakistan was never meant to succeed. And in a sense, there was a view that the country really wouldn't survive for more than 6 months. So I think the remarkable thing about Pakistan's history is not the question that people do ask, is it a failing state, will it survive, will it explode, will the Islamists take it over? But I think the important thing about it is that ever since its creation in 1947, the state was supposed to disappear from the map of the earth. So there was no real certitude about its continuation. So the remarkable thing, the story that I'm telling is how it survived. It's not about will it survive or will not survive, but how it survived and at what price. So the price that Pakistan paid was not in a clear-headed promotion of an Islamic ideology. If anything, Islam became an extraordinarily divisive issue in a country that prided itself for being created in the name of religion. So let me explain that. In the period from 47 to 71, one of the primary issues that Pakistan faced, there were two issues. One was, of course, civil-military relations. But civil-military relations determined in a context where the partition of India had left Pakistan with one-third of the military defense forces and a mere 17.5% of the resource base, and yet with the responsibility of defending the difficult northwest and the northeast extremities of the subcontinent. The British chiefs of staff said that it would cost as much to defend Pakistan as it would cost to defend undivided India. So, I mean, you can imagine with 17.5% of resource base and a third of the defense burden, Pakistan was draining because of the defense burden very soon. I've argued this in my other works as well, and I've repeated that in the struggle for Pakistan, that this is why the center region relationship got twisted and distorted very early on in Pakistan's history. It's, of course, true that the Muslim League was not a patch on the All India Congress, the National Congress, which thanks to Gandhi's, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi's mass mobilization movements in the 20s and 30s had managed to move out of being a debating club to a mass-based organization. The Muslim League never was, and if anything, the Muslim League was weakest in the areas that became part of Pakistan. So as a result of this, it was, I mean, because of center-region tensions, and the other thing that you need to know is that while the majority of the country was constituted by Bengalis. The power in the was exercised in by the West Pakistanis, but the Bengalis were in a majority. So constitution making, which in India took a mere, it was a breeze in India. India had a constitution by November of 1949, and India was a republic by January of 1950. And Pakistan struggled at least 9 years before it came up with its first constitution. And 2 years later, the first coup d'etat took place. The first military coup took place under General Ayub Khan against the backdrop of Cold War politics. Pakistan came, it was entangled into the relationship with the United States by 1954, largely to raise a shield of defense against India. But for the Americans, Pakistan was supposed to be an ally against the containment of communism. People have written of late about the delusionary relationship between the United States and Pakistan. I just want to say that I have the highest respect for Professor Ambassador Haqqani's, but I disagree with him in presuming that the American and Pakistani officials were somehow delusionary. I think relations in international relations, I mean, in the international context, are made in self-interest, and self-interests change. And I don't believe that America and Pakistan were unaware entirely that they did have, from the very beginning, mutually contrary interests, i.e., Pakistan wanted to use the ammunition that it was getting because of joining CENTO and CETO, the Central Treaty Organization and the Southeast Asian Treaty Organization, to raise a shield of defense against India, and the Americans are thinking that this would help fight communism. So I do think that these have been, the Cold War relationship between Pakistan and the United States has a lot of answering to do. And I think that I'm not necessarily blaming the United States per se, but I do think that the first military ruler of Pakistan, General Ayub Khan, has to carry, unfortunately, a lot of the burden of the history. First of all, why was Pakistan made an ally of the United States in mid-1954 against the backdrop of Cold War politics, when the people of Pakistan certainly were thoroughly opposed to any kind of entanglement with either the British or the Americans? I think that that is something that we have to understand, of why the political process was so dicey for those who were trying to get Pakistan onto the bandwagon firmly of the West. Now, I mean, you know, one can disagree about this for all you like, but one result that did happen was that the political process could not be allowed to function freely. It had to be twisted and turned and eventually aborted because it could not be truly, I mean, it was precisely because the military felt uncertain and insecure that it came in to power in 1958. And I mean, after the military came into power in 1958, you know, Pakistan since then has tried all manner of experiments, from popular democracy to controlled democracy to parliamentary system of government. But the dominance of the military is undeniable in the country's history. So if there is something that we have to consider, is not sort of perhaps, I mean, I can certainly talk a lot more about Islam, but the most salient feature about Pakistan's history has been the rise of the military to dominance. A rise that would not have been possible except against the backdrop of Cold War politics. So it would be interesting, I think, now to tell you that what I think happened in 1971. Now, 1971 is when East Pakistan split from West Pakistan, and the commonplace arguments are that the Bengalis seceded. Well, I'd like you to consider, since when have the other way around, in the sense that who seceded from who? Usually minorities would like to secede from majorities. Majorities don't usually secede from themselves. First of all, who seceded from who? In this instance, it's clear as daylight that the problem in East Bengal was, or East Pakistan at this stage, it was called, was really a civil-military issue. After elections were held in 1970 and were won by the Awami League, led by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, and this man, Mr. Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto, Benazir's father, or the leader of the Pakistan People's Party. It's interesting that thanks to Ayub Khan's basic democracy system, which was a controlled form of democracy, and it was an indirect election for both the National Assembly and the president, the people of East and West Pakistan had really not developed the ties that were needed. In other words, the system was such that the center was in charge of patronage. So someone from Rajshahi in East Pakistan had no reason to forge an alliance with someone in Punjab, in Multan. All the person in the Rajshahi district needed was to go to Islamabad to ask. So what happened in the 70 elections is that Mr. Bhutto won well in Sindh and in Punjab, but won nothing in East Pakistan. The Awami League similarly swept East Pakistan, largely because of their long-standing regional grievances articulated in the six-point program by Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, but also because of the handling of a cyclone by the West Pakistani establishment. They were very slow to respond, and there was a sweeping victory for the Awami League in the 1970 elections. But the Awami League's six-point program had not been debated in West Pakistan. And so Mr. Bhutto was in a very difficult scenario of really being in, I mean, he was really between a rock and a hard place, because if he accepted the six-point program and went for the large provincial autonomy that Majib wanted, and I'm not going to go into the 6 points right now, but happy to talk about them later, Mr. Bhutto basically said that he agreed with all the 6 points except two. So it turns out that, you know, when you begin to sort of examine this period, you find that quite apart from the Bengali case, a very solid case of exploitation, the fact that Bengal was used as a milch cow for the industrialization of West Pakistan, it does mean that, you know, it's interesting that by the time Ayub is in power, the situation has started shifting a little bit, and that more is being done for East Pakistan. But the overall scenario, because of the absence of democratic institutions, the political denial matched by economic disparities, growing economic disparities, had already created a scenario of real disjunction between the East and the Western wing. But I do want to say that the leaders, notably Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, until the end kept saying that he wanted to remain with Pakistan. He did not want to split. So again, my question, who split from who? It becomes clear that if I were to give you a little analogy between 1947, because I spent time talking about it, I mean, you can look at 1947 as a triangular battle. There was Congress on one side, the Muslim League on one side, and the British at the base. And the British, of course, were quitting. So it was possible for them to envisage a transfer. But let's come to 71. Here you have the British have been replaced by the Pakistan Army. That's not going anywhere, and so it doesn't really want to transfer power, especially because there is a fourth factor, and that is the India factor. So the Pakistan Army sees the whole issue from the India perspective, and therefore, what my point about 71 is that rather than this being a question of the irreconcilable differences between East and West Pakistan, it was actually a problem of transferring power from a military government to a civilian government. And so, when we look at the negotiations between this man, Bhutto, and Mr. Sheikh Mujibur Rahman, we find that the negotiations never really broke down. They were broken down by the military. In other words, the military intervened before the negotiations ever broke down. So I think that's very important to understand. I think that's where I will stop. So once again, there was no inherent reason why a negotiated settlement of sharing power could not have been arrived at. So I do think that what you're witnessing in South Asia is this inability to learn how to share power, with the result that you have a nation hyphenated state, another one arrives. So I think that this has been an ongoing problem about power sharing and the inability and the refusal. In this instance, of course, the military's refusal to make the concessions that were needed to keep Pakistan undivided. And the result, of course, as you're all aware, was an absolutely catastrophic civil war in which the Bengalis were the principal victims. And so I will stop there about why I... But, you know, after 71, Pakistan, what remained of Pakistan, West Pakistan, had to find a way to reintegrate itself into the international arena, to really brush up its sort of lost morale, something. And the man in charge, of course, was Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto. Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto sought to place Pakistan or really sort of make up for the loss of East Pakistan, which was colossal, by focusing on his long-standing dream, which was to acquire nuclear weapons. So within 2 weeks of coming into power, he convened a meeting of scientists. Pakistan had a nuclear program for peaceful purposes based on plutonium, and he told the scientists whether they would build him a bomb, and whether that was possible in a year or so. Most were reluctant. Certainly the head of the Pakistan Atomic Commission was not in favor, but there were others who felt that it could be done. And so Bhutto started a uranium-based plant, a nuclear weapon program, really as early as 1972, within weeks of coming into power. There is a prior history of it as well, which I talk about in my book, which is that Bhutto, as a young, very young minister in Ayub's regime, because he, of course, did his training in Ayub's cabinet, Bhutto was always in favor of weaponizing, of going nuclear, of building the bomb. And Ayub said that, you know, he was opposed to it because he felt that if Pakistan built the bomb, this would be the end with the West. So here is a tension of great consequence. So what does Bhutto do when he finally comes into power in 71, 72? Begins to strengthen his ties. The first element of his policy is China, Chuan Lai. China was his, basically, it was his baby. He was the one who forced Ayub to come to terms with the Chinese and sign a border agreement, much to India's anger. But China and Pakistan, as you all know, certainly in the current scenario, it's a major relationship that Bhutto has to answer for. The other thing he did was to hold an Islamic summit. I do want to point out that the Islamic summit was held against the backdrop of quadrupling of oil prices, 1973 Arab-Israeli war, and if I may say so, the reassertion or the assertion of Islam led by the Saudis and amongst others. So there was a global assertion of Islam from 73 onwards, and the crowning achievement for Mr. one of the crowning achievements for Mr. Bhutto was to hold this Islamic summit in Lahore, at which he, an occasion he used to recognize Bangladesh, which was a very difficult thing for the Pakistanis. But he did that well, and it is remembered as a great success story for him. As you can see, Shah Faisal was his co-host in bringing this about. Now the question is, why is he doing that? The Arabs had money. Bhutto needed money for his bomb. So I think that we have to sort of acknowledge that the UAE, certainly the Saudis and Libya were generous donors for a program that was obviously secretive but extremely important for Pakistan. And I'd be happy to talk about that later further. So Mr. Bhutto, of course, got into trouble with the Americans, as we all know, because he was... supposedly, nobody knew about the uranium-based bomb, but they did know that he was trying to buy a French reactor, which was based on plutonium. And so lots of people tried to convince him that this was a disaster and that the Americans would make a... Because at that stage, the non-proliferation ideas were very much in prominence in the United States, Carter's period. And so Bhutto... was not to budge. He wanted to go ahead with his French nuclear reactor, and which, with the benefit of hindsight, does seem to be a bit of a ploy to push ahead with his uranium-based weaponization. But nevertheless, Mr. Bhutto did have, he was no Democrat, if I may say so. I mean, he'd been reared in authoritarianism. He persisted, because that was the nature of the Pakistani state apparatus. It's important to remember that he is the only civilian martial law administrator in Pakistan's history so far. We might have others. But I think this is important to remember. So Mr. Bhutto had power in two provinces, Punjab and Sindh. He lost in his party, Pakistan People's Party, did not have anything in the Northwest Frontier Province, which is now the KP, and Balochistan. So he got himself into a tangle with these provinces. They were both Afghanistan bordering provinces. Pakistan has had a long-standing problem because Afghanistan does not accept the Durand Line, the international frontier. And so Pakistan has felt under pressure from both Afghanistan and from India over the Kashmir dispute. So I think that's something that we need to understand. And Bhutto, of course, in going ahead with the bomb, made more enemies in the international arena than he could afford at a time when he was coming under a lot of pressure. When he called for elections in 1977, everyone knew that he would win the election. But the problem was that the margin by which he won was a bit incredible, with the result that no sooner had the results been announced that the opposition took to the streets charging him with rigging. And once again, it was one of those standoffs, typical standoffs that Pakistan is knows all too well, with the politicians trying to negotiate. And then just as negotiations are proceeding, the military suddenly jumps in and calls it off. In other words, you don't let the negotiations go forward. You disrupt the negotiations and you bring about a coup. Ziaul Haq, this man is now chief of army staff, basically carries out a coup against Bhutto. And Bhutto has to blame. I mean, he had some positive things he'd done, notably give Pakistan after a withering defeat at the hands of his premier enemy, he had tried to restore some confidence in the country. He had, of course, started the nuclear program. He also gave Pakistan its first negotiated constitution in 1973, but a constitution that was sadly honored more in the breach than in its actually implementation of that constitution. So now I want to move on to discussing how Pakistan was transformed in the 11 years of rule under General Ziaul Haq, military ruler, a man who had a different vision of how he wanted to proceed, but a man of the time, because this is the period that Pakistan is witnessing. There's a surge of Islamic sentiments, largely in response to a more assertive Islam that's being paraded by Saudis because they have the money. And so Zia basically is a believer but he struggles in the first sort of instance. He hangs Bhutto on dubious charges of murder amid international outcry. It's still recognized as the most questionable case ever that went for a capital punishment, and people are to this day wanting to open it up, but you know, Bhutto can't come back. So he's gone. But the fact, of course, is that Mr. Ziaul Haq got a new lease of life. He was an enormously unpopular man, but he got a new lease of life with the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, which turned Pakistan into a frontline state. And from being a pariah, Zia became a major a player for the United States and subsequently the Western world. And I would say that there is just no question that Pakistan, however reeling and fraught with problems it may have been, was still, as late as the mid-1970s, still a pretty fairly moderate place. For all that we say about Islam being utilized by its earlier rulers for lip service, and I don't deny it, but I think that there's a huge difference between paying lip service to a religion and actually sort of embracing it, as Zia did. And that gave the space to those elements who had been waiting, i.e. the so-called religious elements. I say so-called because these elements are as political as they come, but they utilize the language of religion and therefore are seen as religious as opposed to the so-called secularists. But really the game is the same, it's about power. So he did create the space, but the Soviet invasion, as we all know, really made Pakistan a frontline state. It made Pakistan the recipient of a huge largesse from its largesse of the United States of America. Greenbacks were pouring, and so too the Saudis were matching dollar for dollar. And even if we wonder what happened to the American money, we seem to have some record of that. We have none of what happened to the Saudi money. And so I think the transformation of Pakistan from being a moderate haven, basically, to basically becoming a sort of a hub of the most noxious sort of religious ideology has to be understood. And it occurred during a context where, on the one hand, he was surviving, trying to survive, but on the other hand, he used an external threat to Pakistan to ensure that there would be a longevity for his regime. So I do think that this is when we begin to see Pakistan using Islam for strategic purposes. People think that the problem is with Islam. Well, I think you need to understand that the problem is strategic. Ziaul Haq used Islam to fight the Soviets in order to ensure his own rule, and also because the Soviets were a threat for him at that stage. So I'm happy to talk about that, but I do want you to sort of understand that, you know, we assume that there's some religious problem happening here. But really, I think it's in the framing that you see the religious problem. I think that you are not being able to see the real reason for this. It's just the framing of it as religious. It's not. It's actually a strategic issue. Why he uses Islam, why he uses the Deobandi hardcore Islam to promote and prop up Taliban in his time, of course, it's the Afghan Mujahideen. They are fed an ideology of Deobandi Islam, which was really not the Islam of Pakistan. Pakistan is predominantly a Barelvi country, which is much more shrine-based in its orientation in Islam. And because the government needed these Deobandis, who are populous in the Northwest Frontier Province, where the Pakhtun share a common ethnicity with the Afghans, that the Deobandis were utilized for strategic purposes. And I think that's what has happened. And that is also the reason why the state support for Deoband got the other groups very angry, and why Pakistan has become such a hotbed of sectarian tensions. So this is basically one of the, it's a sort of damage that, collateral damage that Pakistan has suffered for its support for the United States and, of course, the Afghan Mujahideen. But the sad part that I want to talk about is that this policy, I mean, of course, Zia was never appreciated, and not least by the women of Pakistan who took and fought him. And I would say that, if anything, they owe him one thing. By denying them their rights so blatantly, they made them much more conscious of it. And there's been no turning back. The women of Pakistan have always been in the forefront of fighting against military rule. And as you can see, this is they're protesting Zia's black laws, including his law to make the testimony of women reduce the testimony to half that of a man, or to sort of erase the distinction between rape and adultery. So these were the laws of his so-called Islamization program, that instead of bringing social justice, Islamic social justice, as people hoped for, simply targeted women and vulnerable minorities. So much for his Islamization. So, Zia, of course, you all know, died very tragically. Most Pakistani leaders, of course, I must sort of add this, die tragically. We never find out how they die. But, you know, this has been happening since 1951. They die, it's hushed up, and so Ziaul Haq's will never know. They're all manner of conspiracy theories, from exploding mango cases to simply technical faults. But Ziaul Haq took a flight that he shouldn't have taken to Bahawalpur, and on the way back, he was traveling with the American ambassador, sadly, and the entire top brass died. So that was the end of him. The decade that followed, I'll move very quickly, is generally dismissed as a lost decade. But I just want to say that in military, you know, Pakistan has gone through phases of military rule, long phases and short elected governments. But even the most inadequate, incompetent, corrupt civilian government has created more space for democratic processes than military rule. So, I mean, I think that it's while military rule people look upon some people look in Pakistan to this day as the answer to this country, unfortunately, I think it's now clear that even the military cannot quite govern the country as easily, because the complexities. Zia himself left behind a country that was difficult to govern. And so these people who come in, this has been Benazir Bhutto campaigning in the 1988 elections that she won. But she was out of power within a year. Then the next 93 elections, 1990 elections, you have this man, Nawaz Sharif. So they alternated. But all I want to say about this so-called lost decade, it did two things. Pakistan had always had a muzzled press. And you begin to see the early signs of an opening up of the press, partly because of technological changes, but also because of the democratic, the elected governments. The other thing that was very important that happened, that had never happened before in Pakistan, was a more assertive judiciary. The judiciary began to fight in the first instance for itself, to prevent these politicians from nominating senior judges. They wanted to have their own right to judge. So these are two important institutions that had always been kept in control by a military-dominated state, and they now began to kick in a major way. I'm by no means suggesting that the media in Pakistan is fair, free, but I think there's no question that the media is now much more vibrant, civil society is much more vibrant, and so what is important about the so-called lost decade of 1988 to 1999 is that it ensured that any new military ruler would never be able to rule like the previous one. And this is what happens with Musharraf, who I think all of you know a great deal about. That's why I've not sort of highlighted that. But clearly under Musharraf, things went fairly out of control in Pakistan, notably the sort of, it was an involution of sorts of a 30-year policy on Afghanistan that was not changed, and a policy that's connected with maintaining a low-intensity warfare in Kashmir. And I think Pakistan has paid a very, very heavy price. But the reason I'm skipping this is that I want to talk to you about whether or not there has been a change in Pakistan, or whether that is even possible. Have they started recognizing the errors they made with the Afghan war, the support of the Taliban, and the cost for themselves? And I do think that we need to understand that Pakistan had one election, which, of course, led to the colossal loss of Benazir Bhutto because she was assassinated in December of 2007. But that those 5 years, 2008 to 2013, are important because while military dominance remained, Pakistan managed for the first time in its history to transfer power from one elected government to the other. I mean, it might sound ridiculous, but this country never managed to finish, never managed to do that. And it was 2013 that this was done. So I would say that Pakistanis are beginning, politicians recognize the limitations of power, which is the first principle of democracy, in my view, to negotiate, to know that you are limited. And I think that is beginning to happen. And in this period before 2013 elections, not only was a constitutional propriety maintained, but the politicians themselves arrived at a series of amendments through negotiations. So clearly something is happening. The last thing Pakistan would seem to need would be another military intervention, which would certainly put things out there'd really sort of be a very problematic scenario, notably in Balochistan. But the debate that continues to grip Pakistan has been twofold. And am I running out of time? So let me then, I mean, elections in free and fair, well, they were as free as the existential realities of Pakistan permit. And I would only say that so long as the bureaucratic apparatus in Pakistan is fragmented and they look for they look for patrons in political parties, you can't possibly have a free and fair election. It can only be an aspiration. I'm happy to amplify on that. But the most important question is really whether Pakistan can overcome terror. And I do think that it's both a conceptual and existential threat that Pakistan has to face. It did not face it for a long time. Pakistanis have been known to suggest that this is being done to them. It's America, it's Israel, it's of course India. It's never themselves. But I do think that in recent times, it has become clear. That some sort of a shift has occurred, even if it is not adequate from the American or the Indian point of view, i.e. In terms of Afghanistan and Kashmir. But internally, the Pakistan army, after having, in my view, really pushed it and not being able to control these elements, have now realized that they need to go all out to fight these elements. They've moved into North Waziristan, and while a lot more needs to be done, and a lot can go wrong in the future, especially in terms of what happens in Afghanistan, there is now much more of a determination to fight these elements. Secondly, I think that for a long time, the people of Pakistan were extremely confused about this, largely because the media is entirely controlled surreptitious ways, but nevertheless controlled. There is a narrative that does not want to accept that the Taliban are problematic because, you know, they are the good Taliban, they're the bad Taliban. The good Taliban are the Afghan Taliban. The bad Taliban are those who attack the Pak army. So I think that this confusion has finally been put to rest to a little bit. After the attack on December 16th last year, I have never seen Pakistanis more staggered and more shocked. And I do think that that did bring about, has brought about a narrative change. It may not seem to be enough, but I do think that Pakistan will have to continue to struggle. And I can only conclude by saying that nothing has really been decided. Pakistan is not lost to orthodox extremist Islam. The battle is still on for the soul of Pakistan, and the people of Pakistan still have an opportunity to decide their country's future. I'm sorry I've talked too much, but that's what happens when you speak. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So we have microphones on both sides of the aisle. So raise your hand if you have a question. We'd like the students to ask questions first.
Here's one of our regulars, Tom.
Well, I have a question for the students. Having grown up in the era of run, duck, and cover, when we grew up very afraid of the Soviet Union, and you as youth growing up more in the era of perestroika, what did you think about the book in the area of the 1970s when the United States was funding all the extremists and Mujahideen to fight the Soviets? Did you find that interesting, odd, or what?
Katie, you want
to? I don't know.
What did you think, Tom?
I mean, to me, it was kind of normal that we would be trying at that point in the 70s, before the perestroika was just starting, that there was that concern. I think it also shows the roots of where we ended up today.
But I mean, the Iranian Revolution, I didn't have a chance. I've spoken about it a lot in the book, written about it in the book. But the Iranian Revolution is the other very important factor. I think that was playing a very major role. I mean, the loss of the Shah. The support of the Shah, I think, was a blow. And that had to be compensated for at some stage. And there was also a view that in this period, the Soviets were being rather more aggressive, particularly in Africa and other parts. So there was the sense, if you read Gates's work, he makes it quite clear that there was a desire to take more active action. But, you know, I've always, I mean, since I'm now, you've raised this matter, I've always believed that we need to consider the possibility that the Soviets were trapped into Afghanistan as well. Because if you go back in time a little bit and you begin to see what was happening in Kabul in the early 70s, the battle between the communists and the Islamists, Gulbuddin Hikmatyar, Pakistan was supporting under Bhutto. They were supporting the Islamists already. And once that became untenable, and I think the Soviets made an error, but they obviously were driven into making that error in terms of coming in support of their underlings or their allies. And that was, once they were in, it was an ideal scenario for the United States and obviously for Pakistan, in this instance, Ziaul-Haq, who managed to extend his survival for 11 years, longest surviving, thanks to Afghanistan. And as they say, God has given the Pakistan army Afghanistan to enjoy. I mean, this is a joke that they gave the Arabs oil and they gave Pakistan army Afghanistan.
I think we have a question right here. George.
I'd like to thank you very much for a very illuminating talk. I wonder if you could say something about education in Pakistan, about public education mainly, for the average person, and how that may have changed over the decades?
That's an excellent question. I do want to say that the typical conversation about education in Pakistan is, I mean, surrounding extremism, is that madrasas, the religious seminaries. And, you know, it's now clear that the population that goes to the madrasas is minute, not even 1%. And the real problem is the government schools, the government colleges, many of these people who are emerging and into sort of horrendous sort of militants and carrying out acts of terror are actually from government schools. They're either dropouts. And if you look at the curriculum of these government schools, it's horrific. I mean, the hate mongering, the anti-India dimension, and the blatant sort of jihadist, sort of so-called jihadist arguments. I mean, you know, I've written a book on jihad, and I won't go there. But it's arguable what they call jihad is, whether that can be called jihad at all. So this sort of, I think the problem is really at the educational level. It's not just even educating people, but what are you educating them with? So you do have a problem here that whilst there are some very good elite schools where creative teaching is and creative thinking is encouraged, most of it is rote learning. I mean, students are read, teachers read notes to the students that they write down. I remember I was invited to give a talk at the University of Gujarat, which is some 70 miles out of Lahore. And I gave the talk on, they wanted me to talk about partition. So I did. And after the talk ended, this man said, you know, it's all very well, thank you so much. But you see, the problem is that you've created a dilemma for the students. If your history is correct, what should they answer in their exams? So I said they should answer what their books say, but at least their confusion will have ended with my talk. Otherwise, they'd all flunk. So that's...
Hi. Okay. I just wanted to see if you could share some perspective on the large Muslim population that lives inside India, because recently that has been a huge issue, as you know, where we have the BJP, and BJP has some fundamental ideas. And so that makes a lot of the Muslim community uncomfortable. So I wanted to see what your perspective was on that population. And there's this idea that there are some that would still would like to, you know, be aligned with Pakistan versus India. And is that true, or is that just a political, is that a political statement to gain party support?
Well, yes, I do think so. I think that, India, first of all, the Indian Muslims are very diverse. They're spread across India. So it wouldn't be really possible to make one sort of an argument. I will say, though, that what troubles me is not just the fact that the BJP is utilizing the beef ban and the occasional Muslim is getting killed unfairly. My worry about India stems from the fact that if you look at the parliament, Indian parliament, Mr. Modi, of course, won 31% of the popular vote, which is the lowest ever in India's post-independence history. The Congress always managed 41 at least. So it's one of the lowest percentages of popular vote for which the BJP has won very handsomely. And one of the reasons for that has to do with what happened in the UP, Uttar Pradesh, which has the largest number of seats in parliament. So in India, to win in parliament, you have to win in UP and Bihar as well. But UP in particular, just look at UP. There are no Muslim representatives in parliament from UP. And you might say, why? Well, the reason for that is that the vote got split between two contending the Mulayam Singh Yadav party, the OBC party, and the Bahujan Samaj party of Mayawati. So the Muslim vote got split. The Mayawati party won something like 20% of the vote, didn't get a single seat. So these are real serious issues. It just tells you of how fragmented the Muslim vote potentially is, and how it just, you know, Muslims have never voted en bloc, I mean, as a bloc. But in this instance, in UP, I think they were trying, but it obviously didn't work out. So that, I think, the disenfranchisement of Muslims, I mean, they do constitute about 12% of the, or less, 11? 13%. And what is their representation in parliament? You should ask, he's a parliamentarian, what he thinks. I think he's more qualified on this question because he's seeing it. He's a member of parliament as well as an academic. You would like to come and talk? So you want to say something about the Muslim issue? Yes, I mean, it's a very good question, and please ask him.
Well, I would agree with what has just been said, that, you know, the minorities have been feeling a sense of insecurity since the victory of the BJP led by Narendra Modi. And part of that, of course, goes back to what happened in Gujarat in 2002, when Mr. Modi was the chief minister of the state. And there was a state-abetted a pogrom in which at least 1,000 Muslims were killed. But I think far more important is the fact that the Muslims have become a truly unrepresented minority in the 16th Lok Sabha, in which I happen to be a member. Now, I was elected from West Bengal, and there are, of course, a good number of Muslim MPs who have been elected from that state. But from Uttar Pradesh, which has as many as 80 seats out of 543 in the House of the People, there wasn't a single Muslim elected. And that is a problem. And that's why in my first speech, I tried to warn the government not to confuse religious majoritarianism with democracy and uniformity with unity. And I felt that there were many other members of parliament who had to speak up and give voice to underrepresented minorities. Now, of course, the tide has changed in Indian politics. If you've been reading the New York Times, for example, you may have followed what has happened in a state just east of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar. And there too, because of the split in votes among regional parties, the BJP, the Hindu Majoritarian Party, had done extremely well in the general elections of 2014. But just earlier this month, those parties came together, particularly two regional parties with support from the subordinate castes, classes, and also the Muslim minority. And they have won a very decisive victory in the state of Bihar. So I think the concern of subordinate castes and classes and religious minorities are beginning to flow into some kind of a consolidated, you know, political effort to stem the tide of religious majoritarianism. That's where things stand in India right now.
But that, of course, will still not address the larger question of the inherent problem of the Muslim. I mean, you know, the if you read the Satcher Commission report, you'll see how Muslims are suffering on all social indicators. There are some successful Muslims, but they are token. The vast majority of Muslims in India are suffering from forms of discrimination, lack of education. Most of them are employed, self-employed, because they struggle to get jobs. So there is, I mean, and of course the Pakistan factor, whether we like it or not, is constantly used to keep them suppressed. So in that sense, I've always maintained that all problems of South Asia, you need to go back to partition. It has really a lot to answer for, which is why I took so much time talking about it, to put things into perspective.
We have a question right here. Yes, Ellen.
Thank you so much for your talk. It's just fascinating. You know, you opened your comments saying that you were surprised, really, that Pakistan could even be continuing to exist based on how it started. Do you think the role of women there have anything to do with that, seeing how Benazir Bhutto could be leading the country and then be killed and then seeing the women demonstrating? We don't see that in other Muslim countries.
That's a very good question, but let me sort of say a couple of things about that as well. You know, gender, and we talk about gender. Gender is fractured by class. Gender is fractured by region. But we do, for heuristic purposes or for strategic essentialization, speak of women's issues, women's problems. I do want to make a point that Benazir became the Prime Minister of Pakistan despite being a woman. Indira Gandhi, too, in India, was known as the only real man in her cabinet. But the fact of the matter is that both Benazir and Indira Gandhi went out of their way to present themselves not as women's leaders, but as national leaders. And in that context, I think they were constrained in how much they could achieve. Benazir in particular, coming after Ziaul Haq, who had proclaimed these draconian laws against women, was not able to take them off the book. This is something I keep telling my Indian friends, that watch what Pakistan has done. Once you put a law on the statute books, it's much harder to get rid of it than to put it in there. So if the BJP stays and is able to bring about the cultural policing that it's some of its its extensions, its appendages want, I mean, because it's not just the BJP, it's the Sangh Parivar. Narendra Modi might distance himself, but there are some elements who want much more extreme measures. So I do think that in Pakistan's case, Benazir, it was her class privilege that made it possible. Similarly, I think that the women that took on the cudgels against Zia were again middle class women to begin with. And so until and unless, as I've argued in some of my writings, gender in Pakistan in South Asia begins to sort of account, not be sort of determined by class-based accommodations. The poorest of the poor women are not really getting any relief in having women in power or in positions of strength. So a lot more will have to be done before we can take pride in women leaders, because what's happening to women is not, it's completely insufficient. A lot more needs to be done for women. Anybody else? There was a question here. You had a.
Well, I did have a question. I'm not sure.
Hold on
one
second.
Oh, thank you. I said I did have a question, but I'm not sure I still do because I've got so many questions. But I have a question that really is just a personal question. I lived in Pakistan for quite a while, and it didn't seem to me that there was this split between Sunni and Shia that now seems to have been augmented throughout the globe. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on that.
Yes, I do. First of all, I've always maintained that, I think the Shia-Sunni conflict has to be, again, seen in perspective. Pakistan in particular, there's about 20% Shias, very influential. They're educated, well-off people. And they have been living in peace all these years. Socially, there is no problem. Sunnis and Shias marry. But of late, largely as an offshoot of the Afghan policy and the promotion of extremist groups, it has meant that a particular kind of sectarianism has also been fanned as a result, because the Deobandis are Sunni, staunch Sunni, so are the Pakhtuns, so are the Afghans, the Afghan Pakhtuns. And so Shiaism, and of course the poor Hazaras are Shia. So they're getting the brunt of all of this, partly because these are battles for land and space and power. But again, the Hazaras are being attacked in Afghanistan, also in Pakistan, in Quetta. So I do think that we need to be aware that other factors play a role that be very... these are not stable categories, sectarian, these Shia and Sunni. They're internal divisions among Sunnis. So, by taking them as solid categories, we are actually tarnishing our own analysis of the problem. So I would urge people to be more suspicious of utilizing categories like Shia, Sunni to understand what's going on. I think it might be far more fruitful to understand the national rivalries between Saudi Arabia and Iran. I might also point out that it would be useful to realize that whilst Shia Sunnis they've had their problems for years on end, the intensification of this problem in more recent times is a contemporary phenomena, which has to be explained in terms of interventions in the region, which have led to further conflagration. But I do think that there's an element of Iranian-Saudi rivalry that we don't give enough attention to, which is a national rivalry. So I think that we need to be very careful in not it's a self-fulfilling prophecy. The more we've talked about it, the more we seem to be creating it. And I personally think that it's not really the root at all. It's, again, power politics at work. So I think we need to be careful about being too comfortable with categories, because I keep, this is my first point to the students, that the analytical categories you bring to bear on a problem, it's half the issue. That if your categories are wrong, then you're going to end up with difficulty. I mean, if you see this through a sectarian lens, then you'll find sectarianism.
We have a student with a question right here. Sujin.
Hi, thank you for that talk. And I actually have two-part questions. I was wondering if you could elaborate on the two-nation theory that you mentioned in the book. And do you... In your opinion, do you think that Pakistan, even though it still remains in the struggle and a terror...
Sorry, I didn't hear that. Pakistan what?
Even though Pakistan is still remains in struggles and conflict and ongoing, you know, fear and terror in people, do you think the country is progressing toward the vision that Mr. Jinnah had initially had created upon? Or do you think it's now Pakistan is going way... somewhere else?
Yeah, well, thank you very much. That's a very good question. I mean, the two-nation theory, basically articulated by official hacks turned historians, of Pakistan, argue that Muslims were always a distinctive and identifiable community that resisted assimilation into the Indian environment, and therefore Pakistan was an illogical outcome of this historical reality. Well, unfortunately, the historical facts don't match. Muslims are frequently converts from Hinduism. To sort of argue about their distinctiveness simply does not work. So I think that that's the two-nation theory. But I have, in my book, tried to explain how Mr. Jinnah utilized the two-nation theory. I try to say this to you as well, that he used the political category of Muslims to try and make the most of it. In terms of whether his vision is still on course, I mean, you know, I think it was derailed a long time ago. But what's interesting about Pakistan and why Mr. Jinnah continues to be relevant in Pakistan is that everybody from the extreme left to the extreme right invoke him. Now, if the extreme right sees him as a highly religious man, the extreme left sees him as a secular, westernized person. So what I'm trying to get at is that Jinnah's vision is something that is still very much in the public discourse, that people who don't agree with this extremist Islam continue to talk about it. Then there are those who say, well, you know, you've got to take Pakistan for what it has become. Pakistan has become odd. It is something where people are increasingly intolerant. And one has to recognize, this is Zia's Pakistan. This is not Jinnah's Pakistan. But you still have those who believed in Jinnah and believe in Jinnah. So he's more of a normative, his thinking is more normative. The reality is more Zia. I mean, there's more of Zia in Pakistan today than there is Mr. Jinnah, but the hope is still there that Mr. Jinnah's vision will somehow still guide Pakistanis.
Thank you so much for a great lecture.